So in this lecture, we're going to talk about current approaches, current treatments for chronic pain. But before we jump into treatments, let's sort of give a 10,000-foot overview of different categories of treatments. So basically, with something that's as widespread and important as chronic pain, we have a variety of different approaches. One is behavioral approaches, which we'll talk about. We already talked some in the last lecture about the importance of behavior. Also, of course, we have medications. We have medical interventions, which are different than medications. With intervention, we're talking about things like surgery, for example. We have restorative therapies, and we have complementary and integrative health therapies. So let's start with behavioral approaches. So basically, these are psychological treatment approaches like behavior therapy, where basically we're trying to apply principles of operant conditioning to identify and reduce maladaptive pain behaviors, for example, avoidance. And also, of course, we're trying to increase adaptive behaviors. With cognitive behavioral therapy, it's similar but more of a focus on shifting cognitions and improving coping skills. And you'll also remember from the last two lectures, cognitions are very important in terms of the experience of pain. And finally, a more recent version of this is called acceptance and commitment therapy, or ACT, which is a form of cognitive behavioral therapy that emphasizes observing and accepting thoughts and feelings and sensations. I'm living in the present and behaving in a manner that's consistent with your values. Other forms of behavioral health approaches, one that's gaining popularity is mindfulness-based stress reduction. This basically is also focused on awareness and acceptance. However, this is more about teaching patients about meditation, about mindfulness, and giving them a chance, an opportunity to self-regulate pain by developing non-judgmental awareness and acceptance. And so that has been increasingly popular. Biofeedback, less popular, less prevalent. But in biofeedback, you're monitoring and providing real-time feedback about different physiological functions associated with pain. So there are also some additional behavioral health approaches. All these are fairly rare, but you might see them out there. Things like emotional awareness and expression therapy, relaxation training, hypnotherapy. And the problem with behavioral interventions is that while they can be effective, they also can be costly, difficult to access. Insurance coverage sometimes is hit and miss. And also, they mostly come with a pretty high burden in terms of time commitment. And these things, in some ways, make them less accessible to people than other forms of treatment. Medication is another alternative. And now medication, the big disadvantage here is the potential for side effects. So let's talk about non-opioids first. We have acetaminophen, but too much acetaminophen can lead to liver injury. We have non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. The problem there is they can lead to things like bleeds and ulcers. And then we have also antidepressants. And these are a variety of different types, but serotonin reuptake inhibitors and or serotonin norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, and also tricyclics, for example. We also have anticonvulsants like gabapentin and pregabalin, and muscle relaxants like Flexeril. So there also are opioids, obviously, for pain, but also, of course, opioids carry major risks. And we're going to talk about opioid use disorder in the next module. There are a number of different opioid medications out there: hydromorphone, hydrocodone, codeine, oxycodone, methadone, morphine, and all the way up to super powerful, for example, fentanyl. So they carry with them a significant risk for addiction. Even after short-term use, there's a risk for addiction. Tolerance is a problem. Withdrawal is a problem. Overdose. And, of course, the big one is death, oftentimes from respiratory depression. The fascinating thing, too, about some of the most recent research in opioids is that opioids actually can lead to greater pain sensitization. In other words, opioids can lead to worsening of pain over time. So when it comes to chronic pain, actually it can make it worse, not better. So there are also significant side effects beyond what I just talked about, things like constipation, sedation, nausea, vomiting, irritability. There's also the potential for diversion of opioids to individuals who are misusing them. And, of course, there also is the potential for interactions with other medications. So opioids definitely carry a number of risks. We also have medical interventions, epidural steroid injections that can basically deliver anti-inflammatories directly to the epidural space in the spinal cord, nerve blocks, neuromodulation. So you see some of this, how this potentially works over here. The problem with all these, obviously these are invasive approaches, right, and carry some significant risks. And so this is the main problem with these type of medical interventions. There are other ones too, pain pumps, stem cell therapy, you know, some promise here, but also some studies suggesting maybe it doesn't work that great, needs some more research. But there are other interventions, medical interventions besides medications. And now we're going to sort of do a 180 here and talk about restorative therapies. Physical therapy can be helpful, transcutaneous electric nerve stimulation, massage, occupational therapy. So there are a number of other sort of what we'd call more restorative techniques. And finally, we have what we call complementary integrative health. And what I'm showing you here, there actually is a center, a National Institutes of Health Center, called the National Center for Complementary and Integrative Health. And they actually are the group that's funding our work on cannabis and pain. Cinnamon Bidwell is the PI of that work, the principal investigator of that work. But the goal of the NIH, National Center for Complementary and Integrative Health, is basically to define and investigate complementary approaches as those non-mainstream practices that are used together with traditional medicine. And it also defines alternative approaches as those used in place of conventional medicine. So their job is to basically investigate those possibilities. And you can see here they are interested in back pain, among other things. So what kinds of interventions go along with complementary and integrative health? Mind-body behavioral interventions, acupuncture, massage, chiropractic manipulation, osteopathic manipulation. These are the kinds of complementary and integrative health interventions that can be helpful. Other examples, meditative therapies, yoga, tai chi, natural products, dietary changes and changing lifestyle factors, so adopting an anti-inflammatory diet, focus on micronutrients, focus on sleep and exercise and stress management. This is the type of thing that we're talking about with complementary integrative health therapies, and clearly some of these can be important in terms of modifying the pain experience. So to summarize, we certainly have a number of different types of treatments out there for chronic pain. Obviously, they may work differentially. They may be differentially effective for different types of chronic pain. So neuropathic pain, for example, may respond to some treatments and not others. The thing about these interventions that are currently out there, I wouldn't call any of them, you know, super effective, right? There's no silver bullet. That's why there's so many out there, because, you know, one might work for one person and not another. Overall, the effectiveness is fairly modest. Now, opioids, of course, have a reputation or had a reputation for being effective, but the latest research suggests that opioids are actually sort of minimally effective and may actually be, you know, detrimental in the long run. Side effects, of course, for opioids are especially bad. We're going to talk a lot more about that in the next module. Behavioral interventions, obviously, the side effects, really aren't any, right? And they also can be effective. But the only downside to the behavioral interventions is that sometimes the cost can be high, both in terms of financial cost, but also in terms of time and energy. And the same thing is true for more holistic or complementary approaches.